Now, you're probably starting to wonder, am I only going to be focusing on the 30th anniversary of Doctor Who releases? Because so far, there's been a number of them that I've been focusing on and talking about that. It just so happens to be that way. I wasn't really trying to do that, but there are so many good releases that year, and that is what I'm trying to do, is I'm trying to really talk about these stellar releases, like, from the whole range. Because there's some stories that may not require a lot of conversation, others more, and those are the ones I'm trying to get to. And not to disparage anything, but I can't imagine the video for Underworld being all that long. But all the same, this is really focusing on some great stories that also have stories behind the VHS releases, and that's what we're focusing on here today. So, it's kind of hard to balance, but I'm really excited to talk about one of my favorite stories, which is Resurrection of the Daleks. Now, as always, if you want to make any comments, or if you feel like that I made a mistake or something, or you'd like to politely correct me on something, please send me an email. I always am open to what anyone has to say, especially when you're sharing with me your experiences of getting the stories or watching the first time or whichever. I love them. Feel free to check out my Patreon page. We do a lot of exclusives. We have a lot of fun over there. All the stuff that I scan, all the documents that you see in the videos, I put up there for at a certain price level. Also, as well as other videos that haven't been released, and special pieces that haven't been released to the public. For example, for the War Machines, stuff that had to be cut out, I've included that. And also special for the War Machines, we talked about that regeneration scene that was cut into the end of the PBS recording, which didn't happen. But I made a version of that, and I stuck it exclusively on Patreon for those who wanted to see what that might look like. So it's a lot of fun. Please go check it out. Now, as far as Resurrection of the Daleks, to start with, there's just... It brings back a lot of memories. Now, we're going to be talking about a number of things today. There's a lot of moving parts to Resurrection of the Daleks, right? So there's a lot that we can talk about here. see if we can get it all straight. But the thing is, when we're talking... And there's a unique history with Resurrection of the Daleks when it pertains, well, actually, to both sides of the pond when it comes to broadcast, right? The thing is that I always love is when you can collect something, it's released in the same way that it was shown on television. Now, when it comes to the DVDs, I'm not going to be that precious about it, like the opening and closing credits being replaced. I love it. I think that adds to the beauty of the piece. At the same time, I love them when they're not, when I'm looking back at the old VHS range. That being said, Resurrection of the Daleks was a four-part story. I think it was for the Summer Olympics, the coverage, that they needed to combine episodes so that it could fit into the time slot of the Olympics, therefore creating two 45-minute episodes of Doctor Who. So it went from four episodes down to two episodes. And that's how it aired. I don't know if there's really any truth to, like, well, this was a test to see for season 22, or because it got higher ratings, season 22 went that way. I don't know. Once I get to season 22, for these videos, any of them, we can explore that a little bit further. All I know is that it happened. And all I know is that I much would have rather had seen these released as two 45-minute episodes for Resurrection of the Daleks, but because it's always been really a four-part story, it was released in its four-part version. Well, there's going to be variations to that, and my OCD, how bad it is, we'll talk about that in a little bit as well. But also something else about this story that is really interesting and really kind of fun is that there is you know, apart from the uniqueness on the UK side of it, there was a very big uniqueness on the US side of it too for PBS. Now, a little bit of history for how PBS ran Doctor Who in the 80s. They would receive tapes like these. These are 1-inch videotapes, okay? You open it up. This is an Ampeg tape. You open it up, and it is 1-inch video. Now, most of the people watching here are going to be like, we know what this is, and that's fair. I'm just going to take the tape off here real fast. That holds it all together. And as you can see, spool it out, and it's 1 inches. 1 inches! 1 inch of videotape. And I love this. I am so enamored. And this to me is beautiful. Not as beautiful as a 2-inch videotape, but I love it all the same. Now, you're probably wondering, you're not even listening to me, so don't even pretend you are. You're not listening to me. All you're wondering is, like, what is on this videotape? That is all you care about. You people are monsters. It is 10th Planet. No, I'm just kidding, obviously, right? Come on. Come on, we're just having fun here. This is when I worked at Fox 29 in the Twin Cities. This was... they were a big era of Star Trek The Next Generation. And so their whole collection of Star Trek The Next Generation, it wasn't given to them via satellite. They had them all on Beta SP tapes. But this one, for some reason, stuck on 1-inch. And this is actually itself from Fox 23 KOKI in Tulsa, Oklahoma. This says Star Trek Next Generation 126. Now, does it say better on the box? Episode 126. So, does that mean that is season one? I would think that means it is season one. Okay, so now that we got the show and tell out of the way, Doctor Who shows up. For movie version, two of these will take up movie version. So you can't fit it. They're not going to put it all in one spool of tape. So they have VTRs that have the machines up and they're running. And I just learned this from my friend TJ, actually, how this works. I mean, this is how it normally works, but Lionheart, I guess, wasn't all that communicative with the station. So originally, when one reel would end, it would just go to black, and then you just start up the other one. Over time, there was an overlapping on the tapes. So when one would end, the second one would have about 20 minutes of the previous reel, so that during you could try to sync up with a variable player, 1-inch player, sync up the pictures so that you could just cut to the next reel. And I've seen it done, not for Doctor Who, but for a show called The 700 Club, when they would live match up the tape with the live feed live on the air so that they can just do a swap over. It drove me insane watching it, but they were fine with it. But the stations weren't always told, like, there wasn't anything with the tapes that told them that. So, you know, these aren't Doctor Who fans running this stuff. So they, one tape would end, they'd start up the next tape, so it might replay 20 minutes on the broadcast. So when it came to Resurrection of the Daleks, you got two of these tapes, right? The first one, completely broadcast quality, everything perfect on it. You go to the second tape. There is no sound effects. There is no music. So I'll play a little bit of that for you. But what that means is when a Dalek fires at someone, you don't get this Dalek sound effect, and it's just a guy kind of like yelling and then falls down to the ground. I don't know if I remember that, quite frankly, when I watched it originally, but found out, and then I have copies of it, and here's a little bit of it.
What is it? A Dalek. Take cover!
Exterminate! Exterminate! Exterminate!
Where did they come from?
The Daleks won't thank you for capturing me. They'll kill you.
I didn't quite tell you the truth. I serve the Daleks. I'm a Dalek agent.
Exterminate the doctor!
Exterminate the doctor!
Exterminate the doctor!
Exterminate!
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 So it made it very interesting. And I also remember, speaking of how you go from one tape to the next, I also thought it was really weird how in the story, when I was watching it the first time, when it first broadcast on Channel 2, watch it for the first time, and there was all of a sudden a little sign up that said intermission, and that there was like a little weird title on the screen said intermission. It's like, this isn't longer than any other Doctor Who story. Why do we need to have intermission? I didn't understand. Well, now I do understand, because there's probably some kind of mistake of trying to go from one reel to the next. Who knows? They may not even have the second reel up at that point, and they're kind of like running around to get it figured out. Keep in mind, stations had a lot. What people who work in master control, they weren't just making sure that stuff ran. They're collecting feeds from satellites or dubbing tapes or doing whatever else. Just because you have tapes slotted for using for air doesn't mean that they weren't used for other things. And maybe there was a premium on, you know, that they worked out like the timing of getting a dub done so then they can put up another tape and run it so that they can get to the second tape. Trust me, I've worked in TV stations long enough to know that things were done by the seat of the pants. Sometimes it looked very easy. Sometimes there's a lot of running and swearing. So I found that to be very interesting. And I love that. That's what I love about this, especially now that we have the right versions. It's okay. But you know, I didn't even notice. I didn't even notice at the time. You know, give me a break. So as I mentioned, I have a problem. And that is, I want this stuff to be as close to broadcast as possible. To me, I was hugely disappointed when I got, and not this version of Resurrection of the Daleks, but the NTSC VHS that was released by 20th Century Fox. Or Fox Video, I guess, is what it's called. Because I didn't know if it was going to be the two-part or four-part. And I remembered running it ahead, not even watching it. I didn't have the patience for such things. But running it ahead and getting to the 20-some minute mark and realizing that, oh, this is actually, in fact, the four-part version. So I'm like, how do I make a two-part version? Well, back in the 90s, back in 1994, 95... I ended up leaving the Twin Cities area and went down to work at a TV station in Mankato called KEYC. They're still around. And I thought, well, I know how to edit, and as were, the physical editing, not cutting the tape, but the non-linear editing systems where you have to use tape to tape transfers and whatnot. They're professional edit systems. But I thought, well, I can make a new copy, make my own version of the two-part version of Resurrection of the Daleks from the store-bought VHS. And so I did so. One night I snuck in, because my job there, even though my job was production, I felt weird going in and making, for a couple reasons, making a two-part version of Resurrection of the Daleks and trying to explain to someone who would come in being like, well, I need it. You know, I mean, it just doesn't really work. But secondly, having to kind of explain why I'm using commercial video for my own purpose, in my experience over time, no one really cares about that. But when you're young, when you're not even 21, and you're out there and you're just like, I don't know what to do. So I still did it. And it was all in real time. So it's like, you know, you're laying it down as it goes, and I'm re-editing. I'm finding the points where the title sequences match up. So when it goes to part two, you're actually going to part three, and that you're, you know, that you're making it as, you know, as perfect as possible. And I have to say, it was pretty damn good. And I was really happy with it. And, you know, this four-part version, get out of here, I hate you, and all that good stuff. And so I had my two-part version. And then DVD came along, right? And DVD was like, well, for sure, for the DVD, they're going to release, they're going to release it as a two-part version. They figured out their mistake, right? They had to have figured out their mistake from the 1993 VHS release. And what was this? Was this a 2003 or something like this? Let's see here. 2002. Well, I'm the only one who thinks the two-part version is the default version. Everyone, including the BBC, thinks that it's the four-part version. So the four-part version was released on DVD. And in 2002, having a home video editing system wasn't unheard of. A digital one wasn't unheard of, but it wasn't great until a few years later. And I, you know, started really editing in Premiere and stuff. And what I did was I took this and I created, once again, a two-part version. Now, it's odd. It's odd because normally I made like a special case for it in my own covers and stuff. So I don't know where I did with the final version of it. It's funny though, because what I do have, and I pulled these out, as any good editor will do, they keep all their edit files, you know. So this is the whole edit file of like the titles, because I had to redo titles. I had to redo you know, just get some stuff, and this was a really strong edit. So this took up two DVDs worth of video files that, I think I did this with about a year or two spare before they came out with the revisitation of Resurrection of the Daleks, where this actually, they finally saw the light, right? Where this actually came with the two-part version of the story. Finally, here's the question. I'm going to waste all your time even more. I'm trying to see which was the default version. If disc one had it, or if disc two had the two-parter. My guess, disc two probably had the two-parter, even though that would be wrong, in my opinion. But still, whatever. But we're here to talk about the VHS. I also find this very nostalgic, thinking back to Resurrection of the Daleks, because this was the first... Davison was my first doctor, and this was the first time that I knew of new episodes being run on PBS. And I was watching this on my 12-inch black and white TV set in my room late at night, because that's when they aired Doctor Who. And this was before the time of for me, DWM, program guides, whatever. It was really weird that I just had a sense that Tegan was going to leave at the end of this story. I've never seen it before. It was the first time it aired in the U.S., at least on Channel 2. like I said, no pre notion of news or anything like that. And she leaves at the end of it. And I kind of, throughout my time watching the series, not having a program guide, I could always kind of feel like, and it was always movie version, so maybe that's why you could be able to see it a little bit more. I always kind of felt, I knew when a companion was going to leave. When Davison left, that took me by surprise, and we'll talk about that at some point. That still bothers me quite a bit. Now, in issue, DWM issue 201, it tells us about the anniversary year and the VHS with that it's listed in there. And then we go to 206, DWM 206 actually has the picture of the cover on it. So then DWB 118 only listed it as one of the videos coming up in the release. So they have that release schedule listed. You have, go to issue 119, and in there is a review of the video by Alan Stevens. And you read the review, and it has a lot of really good points about the plot. And what's also good about it, too, it's not the J&T bashing that I've talked about in other videos. This is just a very straightforward review with a lot of good points about Resurrection of the Daleks. And some of them, too, because I always look at Doctor Who. I really always look at Doctor Who with rose-tinted glasses. A lot of them was just like, yeah, I can't argue. I can't argue with those, that's for sure. And then, so that's the end of that. But it isn't, because this was all 1993. Let's jump ahead to 2001 with DWM 306. And what we find out there is that they are releasing a thing called the Davros Collection. And in it, at that point, because there was no new series at that moment, all of the iterations of Davros in Doctor Who. So you have this, and so it talks about this being released. This was I believe this was a W.H. Smith exclusive, if I'm not mistaken. This was really interesting at the time. And like I said, at the time, obviously, I'm collecting all iterations of the VHS. So the idea that this was happening without me being able to have a copy of it didn't seem right. I was going to try to get a copy of it. So I couldn't get it through my normal sources because it was exclusive. So I had to get someone to get this for me. So we'll talk more about this one in a second here. So both of these VHS releases are the four-part version, okay? For the cover, this is the cover that is from Bruno Alatorre. And this is a really cool cover, but what gets in the way of the cover is the Doctor Who banner on it, because the Daleks are in the background, and maybe that's the intention, is to have them really far back. But when it comes to Davros, he is front and center. He's green, but that's fine. And then the shot of Davison is basically a direct screen grab, because I think that's his pose at the end. There's like a shot from the end of part one of the four-part version that's where this is taken from. And it's a really nice cover. I kind of wish that the Daleks would have been more into it, to be honest. But it's a beautiful cover. Going over to the Davros collection here, these are all by Black Sheep. And so this is just typical Black Sheep sort of looking covers with a lot of like smog around the characters or whatever is happening here. I'm not quite sure. And it's just floating heads again. I mean, honestly, you have London in the background. It takes place in the warehouses district of London. But I mean, obviously to me, this is always going to win out. And that's just the reality of it. What is also interesting about about these releases, I don't know, and I couldn't get a good answer from it, and it's not anything on the Restoration Team website. I don't think that any work had been done on this release. If so, it's very minimal. What it probably was is, you know, just something to make sure it's not crazy. But if I'm not mistaken, for Genesis of the Daleks, they use the remastered version, and it may not be the entire one. It might not be all the episodes. I'm trying to remember. But remember, there was the repeat run of Doctor Who in 1999 on BBC Two. They start with the Pertwees, and then they switched over to Genesis of the Daleks because the other stuff wasn't really working as well.
A monster. Evil. Dalek.
Doctor Who double bill. Genesis of the Daleks. Tuesday at 6 on BBC Two.
And I think that that's what was released on there. Also, as always, I love to take a look to see what's inside, first of all, the tape, which I don't know if you can see. It has, like, the big sprockets. I always loved that. I don't know why. I always thought it's, like, basically looks like, you know, a broadcast tape or something. It doesn't. Broadcast tapes don't look that way. But then on the inside, once again, and I'll say this every single time, this is just such a kind of a cornucopia of titles, of stuff that I had always wanted, and I never collected them. I did start to collect them on PAL VHS at one point, but now on DVD, I mean, all of this and then some, and that was pretty amazing. What I forgot about, though, was that we had, for these, by the time that these came out, that the what was inside, first of all, they were really pro the Doctor Who brand, which makes a lot of sense. But by this point, we had the pullout of little background on the story and stuff. And I really think that this is a fun thing that they did. And it was, you know, even though maybe the covers weren't always the greatest because of what Black Sheep did, having that little pullout with a little bit of information about the stories always made it seem a little special to me. And, you know, once again, this is in hindsight of how, you know, where we're at now and how much, I mean, the idea of when this comes out on Blu-ray, that virtually probably every piece of production paperwork around this story will be included on the Blu-ray. If someone would have told us that, I mean, that's unheard of, but yet here we are. Just really is exciting to see where we've come from with that. Also, when we're talking about the DVDs, this is part of the revisitation set, and some people were always like, oh, do I have to buy these again? Honestly, I always welcome these because this was a way for us to have versions of these stories that, you know, always getting the best copy, best quality that we can. That's what it was always about for me, always to get the best possible quality of anything. So I always welcomed these. I've always welcomed these. And when you look at this, as well as like Tomb of the Cybermen, which we did, or Seeds of Death, you know, that's why they're worth it, in my opinion. Now, the funny thing about this little guy, first of all, the release originally, Clayton did the cover for it, which I think is a great cover. He had, and I'm wondering if these were the model Daleks that he had, that he photographed. He had Davros looking the other way, it sounds like. But Steve Roberts, who was virtually head of the range at the time, he suggested moving the Davros looking back into it, because Davros wouldn't turn his face away from the Daleks. That's commitment. So, and this is before we had printed covers. But what we also had on here, I don't know why this was a selling point and why they did it at all, but you had this ugly thing that was wrapped around it, this little, like, DVD condom that was, I don't know if this is Dalek bumps or roundels or what. I mean, I don't even know if I can get this in here because I've never... Why do I want to... why do I want to cover up a cover? You know what I mean? But this is what... This is how it came. And this is what it looked like. And I'm, quite frankly, super shocked I still have it. But here we are. That's what happens when you don't throw anything away. So... That was very interesting. And I forgot all about this until I ran across and I'm like, whoop, this works out fine. I'm going to be talking about the story. Let's compare. Let's compare to see what we have come across. And this might, when I say this out loud, it may not work in edit because there might be a lot of stuff on screen that doesn't make it work. But I would love to see... At least comparisons between this, and this. We'll see if that works or not. And from there, if not, I'll, you know, you'll see it. It's fun. Here's what comparison and quality.
A soft, like all Time Lords, you prefer to stand and watch. Action requires courage. Something you lack.
So that's what that looked like. Imagine how many... I mean, that's just Resurrection of the Daleks. And there, for Resurrection of the Daleks, I have 1, 2, 3, 4 official versions of it. Let alone my unofficial versions, my edits, and my movie versions, and stuff like that. And it's not even like a main story. I mean, we really collect Doctor Who, don't we? We really do. Wow, that's amazing when I look at it that way. With that being said, as always, please consider... joining my Patreon. I would greatly appreciate it. We do a lot of special stuff for our subscribers. Please check it out. It starts out very low every month in terms of how many dollars it takes to do so to keep us happy and going. I'd appreciate it. And then, of course, if I missed anything, please send me an email. Let me know. And we will, you know, correct down the line or whatever else. It's always fun to talk about these releases. And, you know, as until I see you again, just remember, Braveheart.
And there are more space adventures on these BBC videos.